are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome to Political Science 101, American Institutions. My name is Brenda Riddick, and I am your instructor for this class. And so this evening, or this afternoon, we're going to be talking about Congress and a couple of things I want to share with you about the syllabus. I know on the syllabus, as a matter of fact, let me just start now. On the syllabus, it says that this week we'll be talking about the presidency and bureaucracy. And actually, we're going to move that out since we didn't have an actual broadcast class, live broadcast class last week, as it was President's Day and the campus was closed for classes. So we didn't have Congress last week. We'll be doing Congress this week. So we're gonna be bumping some things down. But those changes will be reflected on your course syllabus, and I'll send those out later this week so you know what you need to be prepared for when the midterm exam comes up in a couple of weeks. All right, so when we last met, we talked about civil liberties, civil rights, or we've actually covered civil liberties and civil rights. The last broadcast, live broadcast that we had was focused on civil rights and some wonderful questions that you guys asked me, some comments that you made. I want you to do that the same as you've been doing, very interactive and engaging. Send me your comments to askdhtvlive@gmail.com. And then, of course, you can always call in. And we've had a few of you call in and ask your questions. You can do that at 1-800-339-1193. I'll answer your questions and pose them back to the group, to your classmates as well, to see what kind of comments or perspectives that they want to share with us about what you ask when you call in. So don't be afraid to do that. By all means, you can call in. In fact, you earn 2 points for call-ins as opposed to 1 point for sending me your comments on the DHTV Gmail, Ask DHTV Gmail account. So today we're going to talk about Congress, and boy, is there a lot to talk about related to Congress. Tomorrow, actually, the president is going to be doing his address to Congress later tomorrow evening, and so he is now preparing what that address will look like and what it is that he wants to share with Congress, his agenda that he would like assistance with Congress to pass during his 4 years as president, his first 4 years as president. So that should be some enlightening information that we all should be able to see, hear, and digest over the next couple of days. And of course, we'll have a touch on it a little bit when we talk next week, because we'll be talking about the presidency and bureaucracy next week. So if you have a chance to watch his address tomorrow evening, I would encourage you to do so. It'll give us some additional, I don't know, information, perspectives, viewpoints over the next 7 days to think about that you can share then with me on next Monday's broadcast. So I ask you, or I actually suggested to you, that we have a lot to talk about related to Congress. So I'm gonna get my materials ready. And as we do every week, I will be sharing with you some video clips on different perspectives about subtopics that we have in this particular chapter. And you guys can watch the videos and then come back at me with your thoughts and your comments. So be prepared for that this afternoon as we talk about Congress. But I wanna open it up with asking you, have you heard any jokes about Congress lately? And get your perspective on Congress, on what's right and what's wrong. I'm gonna share with you some thoughts about the approval rating as it stands today. Actually, it was captured by Gallup in January, the first week of January, I think it was January 4th through the 8th of this year. And then I'm gonna take us back as far as trending. We'll look at what the same period of time in 2016 looked like for approval and disapproval of Congress. And then we'll go back to 2015 and see if there's been any change from 2015 to 2016 to 2017 in how Americans feel about Congress, their views on the good job that they're doing, or their views on whether or not they're not satisfied, or disapprove of what Congress is actually doing on their behalf, remember, as a representative entity of our democracy. All right, so let me get my materials ready, and we will talk about Congress. And of course, I need my glasses, so let's do that. All right. So I ask you, had you heard anything, any jokes, any comments about Congress and the work that they're doing? And so I will start it off by asking you, heard any good liners about Congress lately? So, and not having seen any comments yet. Mine is, if pro is the opposite of con, what's the opposite of progress? Now think about that for a minute, and if you have a logical answer for that, come back at me, and in a second I'll tell you, or a couple of minutes, I'll tell you what the answer is. All right? So in talking about chapter 6, we want to be able to understand Congress and all the challenges, all the responsibilities, all the roles, all the oversight, all the checks and balances that Congress is responsible for, the membership of Congress is responsible for. And we want to make sure that we understand who represents us as far as the power that exists within the individuals that represent each one of us as citizens. How many of us, how many House of Representative members there are, how many U.S. senators there are, and the makeup of both the House of Representatives and the Senate. What is it that they're sent to go do when we elect them and put them in office? And what's worked and what hasn't worked? All right, so members of Congress are ultimately responsible for both representation and lawmaking. That's what we send them there to do. That's what we send them over to the big house, that beautiful dome building in Washington, D.C., to do for us on a daily basis, okay? We ask them to do that in a partisan way, a nonpartisan way, where they are actually working together with each other across the aisle to negotiate policy, lawmaking, representation on our behalf as the citizens of this country. And we need them to do that in such a way that it's amicable, it contributes to the well-being of the greater whole of society, that they are policies that benefit the majority, and that they're fair, equitable, that there is a level of integrity, there's transparency and accountability when it comes to all the duties that they uphold and are sent to go do, again, on our behalf. That doesn't always work out the way it's supposed to, but remember, their responsibilities are for representation and lawmaking. So how does all of that unfold? Okay. These two duties are often at odds with each other, representation and lawmaking. Why would they be at odds with each other? What are some of the issues and concerns, I ask you? Well, I'll tell you. Because sometimes what's for the good of a local area or a district that an individual, either senator or House of Representative member represents, may not be what's good for the nation. And so there's this conflict, there's this balance that they have to figure out and weigh. In the interest of the individual who's working on behalf of their local district, their local area that they represent, is that particular lawmaking or that particular policy that they're about to vote on, is that not just good for their own local area, but good for the whole country? Because they're voting in that way. Or are they voting for what's only good for their locality, but may not be in the best interest of the greater whole of the country? Those are some of the dynamics that they have to weigh as our representatives. And so therefore they become conflicting issues on how to figure that out. The need to secure re-election by catering to local and increasingly partisan interest often means that representatives have fewer incentives to concentrate on the bigger picture, the national lawmaking that we send them to go do. In the conversation we're going to have today, I want to talk about the time that is spent in preparation for re-election that takes away from the opportunity for our legislators, our congressional people, to actually fulfill the role that they're supposed to fulfill in the time frame that they're given. One of the extra credit questions that you guys had for last week focused in on term limits. Are term limits fair? Should we have term limits? Are term limits good for the rotation of members within the House of Representatives and Senate that make up Congress, or not? Is there anything wrong with a congressional member serving, being elected to serve term after term after term, somewhere in the area of, I don't know, 20 to 26 years, 20 to 28 years, as long as they're doing a good job, making meeting approval ratings for the majority of the people that they represent? Is that a good thing? Or should we have term limits where they are out at a certain time and cannot continue on, that their livelihood, that their existence, what they're structured around, what they're identified with, needs to be narrowed into something less than 20, 25, 30 years? Or does it even matter? As long as they're doing the work of the people and the people are okay with it. All right, so things to ponder. All right, representation style takes four different forms. You have policy, allocative, casework, and symbolic. And a successful member of Congress needs to excel at each one of those. Not just one, but they need to be able to excel at each of those four elements. So we'll talk about that in just a minute. As we get started, let me share with you, Congress and the public, the congressional job approval rating that I said I would talk about with the Gallup poll. These are Gallup historical trends from the last 3 years, including this year, 2016 and 2015. So in 2015, when asked the question, do you approve or disapprove of the way Congress is handling its job? In 2015, the approval rating was at 16%. The disapproval rating was at 76%. And about 8% of the country that was polled had no opinion at all whether or not they were doing a good job or not. Now, look at a year after that, in 2016. This was in the month of January that these were taken, that I'm reporting on. They were taken every month, but I'm just reporting on January because that's where we are in 2017. So I want to give us an analysis between January 2015, January 2016, January 2017. So contrast that with January 2017, same week, and we're looking at, again, a 16% disapproval rating, I'm sorry, 16% approval rating, an 80% disapproval rating, and instead of 8 people not having an opinion, in this case, we only had 4 people that did not have an opinion one way or another. 4 of the original ones from the, 4 from that 8 number that was counted back in 2015 moved into the disapproval slot. In other words, there were 4 more added to the disapproval slot in 2016 than there were in 2015. All right, now let's fast forward that to January, first week in January of 2017, this year. Approval rating went up to 19%, so it went up 3 points. Disapproval went down a little bit to 76, so in 2016 it was at 80%, 2017, 76%. And then 5% had no opinion at all. So are people, are Americans happy with the work that Congress is doing? I ask you guys to share with me what your thoughts are. In conversations that you've had, in the work that you understand Congress is responsible for, generally, is America happy with the work that they're doing? Yes or no? All right. So where I shared with you, actually I'm looking for my video sheet because I want us to see a video and I seem to have moved it somewhere else. All right, here we go. What are the essential tensions among representation, lawmaking, and partisanship? So I told you that there are some balancing acts that Congress has to figure out between these different responsibilities and roles that they have, and there is a conflict between representation and lawmaking. What does that look like? For the local, good different from, the local good is different from maybe what the national might need. I shared that with you a few minutes ago. difficulty for members to fulfill their collective responsibility again at the national lawmaking level. And it explains why, in this instance, it might be a harsh word to say, but why Americans hate Congress or don't feel as loyal to Congress as some would hope or some members of Congress would like as a whole, but love their own senators and representatives. So when you look at the big picture, people are not very happy or pleased with the work that our congressional members are doing at the in the big picture. But if you ask them how their own individual senator or representative is doing, they love it. They love the work they're doing. They're fully supportive of it, even though they may actually not be doing what they should be doing, or they may not be doing something that benefits their particular district or area. So there's a difference there. Example, a member of Congress might vote to pass a budget needed to keep the country running, but it might have a provision to raise taxes slightly, which the representative or the senator promised when they were running for election that they wouldn't do that, that they would not vote for, in this instance, a tax increase. That was something on their campaign platform that they said they would never do. But once they were in the position where they had to make a decision, either voting at the local level or voting for something at the national level, in this instance, a budget, they went with voting on the budget, and as a caveat of that vote, that they had to raise taxes, which was totally against what they said they would do from their platform position when they were running for office. House of Representatives, what is their time in office? What's their term? It's 2 years. For Senate, what's their term? 6 years. Okay, so I said earlier that we have on term limits, asking you about term limits, we have individuals who have been in office for multiple terms, good, bad, or indifferent. So you guys can weigh in on that. All right, the first clip I want us to see is, this comes from a TV show we called, that series that used to run a while back. It doesn't run on TV anymore, but you can find it on YouTube and probably Netflix. It's from The West Wing, and this is the House, Speaker of the House talking to the president about an issue that they're going back and forth on. And the president finally says he's going to shut it down. So listen to the dialogue, listen to the dynamics of how the Speaker of the House and the president and the people that are in the room who are listening have to work through this particular issue and the decision that the president ultimately makes, and come back at me with your thought. Remember, the Speaker of the House is in Congress. That's a person that is in Congress. And this person is the high-ranking person in Congress who has to speak to the president. And for instance, tomorrow, Paul Ryan is the Speaker of the House today, Congressional Speaker of the House today. And so he has to work with President Trump on the agenda that President Trump would like to have passed. In fact, I'm going to speak to you in a few minutes about how the news is reporting the preparation that the Speaker Ryan is going through with members, the Republican members and Republican Party members, to prepare for tomorrow's address by President Trump and some things that he's trying to work out with members of his party to support President Trump. So go ahead and take a look at this clip, come back at me with your thoughts, and we'll move on.
Hello. Bob. Mr. Speaker, Senator.
I want to thank you, Mr. President, on behalf of my colleagues. None of us think this is a perfect deal. No one likes to see the sausage made, including the guys who make it. But this is an expression of willingness by both sides to keep all avenues open to an eventual resolution.
Yes, thanks, Robert, and thanks for saying it this time. I think I had to make that little speech the last time around. Or maybe the time before. This is our third CR, our third time coming up short. We got to do better. People aren't paying us to duck the hard choices. You want to run through the details, Angela?
An act of Congress. A continuing resolution to extend no later than January 3rd, midnight, to include a reduction by 1%.
Excuse me, Mr. President, I'm sorry. There's been a change. I know we talked about a 1% cut. It's going to have to be 3.
Mr. Speaker, nothing like this was even mentioned, much
Hold
less...
On. I'm sorry we couldn't get more notice, but we just came from our conference, and I had significant opposition to only 1%.
Only 1%?
Yes, sir.
We had a deal at 1%.
But now my members have to go back to their districts for the holidays, explain why we kept the gravy train running with a rising deficit and an economy crying out for tax relief. It's an economic situation that calls for action, not status quo spending. 3% may sound painful, but it's only for 2 months. It'll show we're serious.
What's next?
Sir?
In 2 months, 5%? 50? How many rounds do we go, Jeff? I'm just asking.
There is no next, sir. I mean, not to get too technical, but this government runs out of money at midnight, and my guys have gone home. This is it. There is no altering this offer, Mr. President.
And I said no.
Let's be clear, sir. We cannot, we will not vote to keep on footing the bill. You will be held responsible for shutting down the federal government.
Then shut it down.
So that's a real life kind of situation that really does happen, and it has happened over the years, where the president and the speaker of the House have to make a decision on budgeting. And we could get into a situation where we don't have enough money to support us as a federal government. Federal government can't support the states can't support the localities. And then we have a government shutdown. We had a government shutdown a couple of years ago where everything stopped. There was no funding put in place to cover essentials. As far as the federal government, of course, your intelligence agencies were still up and running. FEMA was still up and running for emergency situations. Things like parks and rec were closed, museums were closed, libraries were closed. There was a lot of things that were closed and shut down because of the dynamics between the president and Congress, or within Congress, the dynamics between the parties and what happens between the Senate and the House of Representatives. And when everything goes haywire and there's no affirmative decision to move government forward with the funding that's required to keep it operational, then we shut it down. And in that instance, in that example, which is fictitious, but in also a reality, the president makes a decision to shut it down. Does that mean that we are working on behalf of the interest of the greater whole of the majority of the citizens in this country, whether it be the employees that work for government, the recipients of the services and programs that are provided by government, vendors who need to be paid by those fundings from the government, our global allies that we have a responsibility for? There's implications for everything that happens when those kinds of situations are determined to fall that way. Do you blame somebody for that? Well, yes, the blame goes back and forth. People take accountability and people push back and say, it wasn't my responsibility. If this would have happened, then this would have been the result of that. So it goes back and forth, but does that benefit us as a country? Does that benefit us as a nation from people looking outside in and seeing how we operate in this democratic society? It is a part of our democratic process, and so it does happen. All right, so let me take you back for just a moment to what the definition of representation, lawmaking, and this issue around partisanship. What am I talking about when I give you those terms? And it's in your text, but let's just talk about it real quick. So representation, these are the efforts by elected officials to look out for the interest of those who elect them, including keeping election promises made to the voter. So that's what we expect when we elect an individual into office, that they're going to represent the things that they stood on their platform and said they would do for us, doing the right thing. All right. And then lawmaking, what's the difference between representation and lawmaking? Well, in lawmaking, you're creating policy, you're creating legislation to address problems and needs of the entire nation, not just, again, your local area, but what's in the best interest of the entire nation, including making laws that help keep the country running. So I gave you the instance, you saw the video clip a minute ago about the West Wing, and the series is called The West Wing, one of my very favorite, about how government operates. One that is on today, in case you ever have a chance to look at it or review it, you can get some of the copies from the library, or you can tune in on Netflix, is House of Cards. And House of Cards kind of picks up where West Wing left off a few years ago, in the way that people ask if it's real, if this is really how government operates. I leave that up to you after you watch a couple of episodes. In fact, I might have us watch a couple of episodes just to have an understanding of how reality, how fictitious, something fictitious can become our reality in nanoseconds. All right, so then you have representation, you have lawmaking. What is partisanship? What do I mean by that? And I've talked about partisanship over the last few weeks in some of our other broadcasts. It's the loyalty to a party that helps shape how members see the world. What is it that they understand from an ideological standpoint that represents their interests, their values, and their belief systems? It's how they define problems and how they identify appropriate solutions to those problems. All right, so I said I would share with you just quickly. Congressional Republicans have finally come up with a strategy to deal with President Trump. It won't work. This is from the Washington Post, and this one is from, this particular article is dated February the 13th from an author, last name is C-I-L-L-I-Z-Z-A. And I'll just take a couple of terms, a couple of comments, statements from this. So quoting, it says, in the last two midterm elections, which were 2010 and 2014, have taught us anything, it's that the president's party goes as the president goes. Goes on to say that in 2010, Democrats lost 63 House seats. 4 years later, they lost 23 House seats. In each of these elections, Democratic House members did everything they could to run from Obama and some of his less popular policies, like the Affordable Health Care Act. End quote. And then in another section, it talks about, quoting, at least according to early polling, Trump is one of the most divisive and unpopular presidents in modern history, end quote. All right, so what's happening with that? Well, Saturday, there was an election for the Democratic National Committee that is readdressing some of the concerns and issues that they had with the Democratic Party and the election that we had in 2016. How do you recover from all of that? And so there was a new chairman elected to that position. There was some dynamic opposition that was going on between the individual that was actually voted in and the person who was running against him. And the result from that election, let me just take you to who won. It was the Democrats elected Tom Perez, who was the former Secretary of Labor under the Obama administration, to become the new DNC chair. And his opponent was Congressman Keith Ellison. Keith Ellison was supported by Bernie Sanders, the contingent, and Bernie Sanders, who supports Bernie Sanders. And the dynamics of what happened when the election results were claimed was not very pleasant. Some of the supporters, Bernie Trump supporters, when they heard who actually won, and it was a very close race, a close election, they walked out while the announcement was being made. And so this new person who is taking over this responsibility is coming into a divided party within the Democratic structure and the Democratic Party. So you still have issues that are going on within the parties. You have issues from the Democratic Party, you have issues from the Republican Party. How do we unravel all of that, fix it, and make them work for us, make them work for the good of the country? Well, we'll have to see what happens with the new DNC chair and what the vision is for the Democratic Party to come out of the darkness where they are today, based on what happened in 2016 and the ultimate decision that was made during the presidential election in November of 2016, and what's going on now with President Trump as our new president and CEO of the United States. Okay, so what are the differences between the House and Senate? What happens between those two? And I see you guys are making some comments. Keep the comments coming and I'll reflect on them in just a couple of minutes. What are some of the things that are going on between, or the differences between House and Senate? How are their jobs different? How are they similar? What are they there for? Okay, and then I'll cover Paul Ryan's preparation for President Trump's address on tomorrow. In your thinking about what are the difference between the House and the Senate, I'm going to share with you a video in just a minute, but I want you to understand as far as the role of partisanship in understanding the differences between House and Senate and the parties within House and Senate. Members of Congress have juggled a commitment to the party with the simultaneous need to represent us, the voters. That's who we elected to go there and handle business for us. But the political parties in the United States have varied over time in their polarization. And in my opinion, in the last 8 years, we have had a very polarized congressional body. Not very much work has come out of Congress that represent the needs of us, the constituents, the people who put them there. That's my opinion. You guys may have a different opinion. But the polarization, that is, and how great the ideological differences are between the two parties and how much ideological agreement there is with them. Or within them. So in today's political climate, when the parties are deeply polarized, partisanship happens, okay? Partisanship has turned into something more of what we call hyper-partisanship. Hyper. It's bigger than a bread box, all right? Or a commitment to a party so strong that it transcends all other commitments. My head is going into the sand and I am not pulling it out for any reason, no matter what, even if it's in the best interest of the greater whole of this country, even if it's in the best interest of my party, even if it's in the best interest of making a compromise, I am stuck in the sand and I'm not moving. That's hyper-partisanship, okay? Leading members to choose party over constituent over national interest. That is not good for the country when that happens. But that's been the state that we've been in for some time. How do we move out of that situation? All right, party polarization, the ideological distance between the parties and the ideological homogeneity within them, within the two individual parties. Okay. So in my question in asking you about the differences between the House and the Senate, let's go ahead and take a look at this clip. This is about a congressional committee hearing on the Flint, Michigan water crisis that came about. And I want you to observe the dynamics between your congressional members on the committee asking the questions and probing for information from the individuals on the other side of the table who have the answers that Congress is looking for. But watch the dynamics between the individuals on both ends, your Congress and then your agency people, and give me your thoughts on, is it working? Did they get what they needed? You're only gonna see about 3 minutes, 3 minutes, 45 seconds of this clip. It goes on for like 12 minutes, but I wanted you to see this, and this is something that is captured by C-SPAN every week. Every day that Congress is in session, C-SPAN captures the hearings that occur within Congress for different issues. So go ahead and take a look at it, come back at me with your thoughts and we'll move on.
For 5 minutes. Governor, you've apologized, correct?
Correct.
Have there been people that have been fired?
Correct.
Anybody also dismissed or otherwise retired?
Yes.
Did the state of Michigan do something wrong?
Yes.
Administrator McCarthy, the EPA do, in your mind, did the EPA do anything wrong?
I don't know whether we did everything right. That's the challenge that I'm facing.
Now, the challenge you're facing right now is my question. And my question is, did the EPA do anything wrong?
I think we could have been, I would hope that we would have been more aggressive. I would hope that we would have escalated this issue. If we could have done absolutely anything to stand on a rooftop and scream about the challenges we're having
okay,
in the
so
conference,
you're we just
have done
not.
It.
Here's the fundamental difference. First of all, we have jurisdiction here in Congress on the EPA. I don't have jurisdiction on the governor. I don't have jurisdiction. I have jurisdiction to call him up here, and Republicans did call him up here. He volunteered to be here, and we are investigating. This is our third hearing on this topic. But here's the fundamental difference, and I hope you and I hope everybody understands this. I see responsibility. I see people that are getting fired. I see changes. I see an admission that there was fundamental wrong that happened in the organization. But then when I turn to the EPA, has anybody been fired? That's a question.
No, sir.
Has anybody been dismissed?
No, sir.
When the EPA Region 5 administrator there, Susan Hedman, mm-hmm. the day you finally did take decisive action, when you were questioned about that, you said that her act of stepping down was courageous.
I did.
I'm going to ask you again. Did the EPA do anything wrong?
The EPA worked very hard. Let me make one point.
Okay, no.
Let me make
one. No, because I have another question for you. No, hold on.
Okay.
Did the... Mark Edwards has testified here twice. He doesn't have a dog in this fight other than he wants good quality health for people, and he wants good clean water. And he happens to know the science behind the water. On those two hearings, did Mr. Edwards say anything that you think was wrong? Or maybe or inaccurate? Do you think Mr. Edwards said anything that was inaccurate or wrong in those two testimonies?
I think he was not at all informed about what EPA did. I think he knows nothing about the law, which he readily admits.
He knows
nothing. He doesn't know how we're supposed to work in the system. He doesn't understand that the problem itself was the responsibility of the states. Oversight was our responsibility. We took that seriously, and we conducted it. Does that mean I don't have regrets? Because I'd really like
No, that's a whole different standard. Everybody can say that's cheap. Oh, yeah, we just got regrets. That's cheap. That's cheap.
Well, okay? So you have to look at how the law works, and we did
that. Yeah, you know what? And it failed. You failed. You said, quote, if there is anything I could do, if there was any switch I could pull, you had that under the law, and you didn't do it.
No, sir, I did not have that under the law.
Yes, you did.
Wow. Administrator McCarthy from EPA was really taking a hit on the Flint, Michigan situation and not being able to answer the questions in the manner that, or with the information that Chavez wanted. My, okay. So that's what happens sometimes in Congress when you have committees and you have situations that affect Americans, and we don't have answers for them. Congress wants to know why certain things happen. Why do they want to know? Because we're asking Congress, why did this happen? Why was this allowed to happen? The Flint, Michigan situation should never have happened. But do we have Flint, Michigan situations all over the country? Absolutely. Right here in our own backyard in Watts, we have a Flint, Michigan water situation. In other populations, in other parts of the country, we have similar situations. So constituents will ask their local representatives in the state, in their districts, why are these things happening? Then they have to go over to their congressional members and ask their House of Representatives, their senators. Well, your state assembly people and your state senators are asking these questions because their constituents are asking these questions. We need answers. And so you have hearings. And from the hearings, people get blamed. People get asked, why did this occur in the way that it occurred? What's the answer to resolve this? The American citizens are looking for resolution, and they want it now. They also want to know who to blame for that situation that occurred to begin with. So you got a little bit of that out of that particular clip. All right, so I want to take us to what are the four kinds of representation that exist within Congress. We have policy representation. This is congressional work to advance the issues and the ideological preferences of us, the constituents. Okay, us constituent citizens, the people that our congressional members represent. Then there's allocative representation, and this is congressional work to make sure that they can get certain projects done, secure projects, services, and funds for their particular represented district. So allocative, appropriated, these are things that the individual wants to have happen, approved and happen and have funding to support in their given district. An example of that would be pork barrel or earmarks designated specifically for their district. Public work projects and grants for specific districts paid from and by the general funds fall under allocative representation. Then you have the third one, which is called casework. Casework is legislative work on behalf of individual constituents to solve their problems with government agencies and or programs. And so us as individual constituents, citizens, may have a concern or an issue that we need our representative to move forward on, to consider, to take into consideration for action. And so it gets assigned as casework representation. So someone in that district will work on it on an individual, my individual level to that individual, to our representative. I have a problem I need my representative to look into and work on that's affecting me, that's going to be resolved for in the way of a program situation or some benefit that's going to address that problem. And then we have what's called symbolic representation, which are the efforts of members of Congress to stand for American ideals or identify with common constituency values. So symbolism, symbolic representation. All right. What are the differences between the House and the Senate? Your textbook talks about them. I'm just going to give you a couple. I've already told you that for term limits, one has 2 years, another has 6 years. Which one has two and which one has six? House of Representative members have 2-year terms. Senate has 6-year terms. All right, the age, the required minimum age requirement for House of Representatives is 25, whereas for Senate, it's 30. So if any of you are aspiring after, while you're in college, and as you get through college into grad school and beyond, whatever your career goals and endeavors are for life, if you so desire to represent from a political perspective, from a human perspective, some aspect of the political world, you know that your age, minimum age requirement to get into or to run for House of Representatives or Senate is either 25 years or 30 years, depending on which side of the House you're going to go to. Citizenship required. You have to be at least, for the House of Representatives, at least a citizen for at least 7 years, and on the Senate side, at least 9 years. Apportionment, which we're going to get into with gerrymandering in just a moment. Apportionment are changes in with population on the House of Representatives side, and then on the Senate side, it's fixed entire. All right, so on residency in the state, if you're going to be House of Representatives, if you're going to run for that office in your state, you have to have residency in the state that you're running for the House of Representatives. And the same goes for the Senate. You have to have residency. If you're saying that you want to run for Senate, senator in the state of California, well, you have to reside in the state of California. You can't reside in Utah and run for in California. It doesn't work that way. Those are the rules. Organizational differences. House of Representatives has 435 members. Your Senate has 100 members. Okay? So committees. There are a number of standing committees in both. In the House of Representatives, you have 20. In the Senate, you have 16. All right, and then there are issues around, hopefully we'll get to the filibuster, but limits on floor debate possible? Yes. In the House of Representatives? Yes, definitely. In the Senate? No. No filibuster possible. Okay? All right, so why is geography a better basis for congressional representation than, say, race, religion, gender, occupation, socioeconomic status, or socioeconomic group? Why is geography a better indicator, a better choice than those other elements that are factors that I just shared with you? We're going to look at a clip in just a couple of minutes about census and apportionment. Remember I told you apportionment was one of the responsibilities that we have in House of Representatives and Senate. You need to be able to appropriate funding. It's decided on a lot of factors, but also from a geographical standpoint. Whose district do you represent? What's the population in that district? Has it shifted? Has it changed? What's the socioeconomic dynamics within that district? What is it you're looking for funding to support? What kind of projects are you trying to find funding for? Okay, how are districts drawn? When you want to represent somebody, I'm sorry, my ear is itching. when you want to represent a particular area, what is that area, how is it constructed? How is it decided that your particular area that you are desiring to represent is made up of this body of constituency? How are those things decided? Okay. Let's go ahead and take a look at, before I get you into, no, we'll wait. Checks and balances. What's the difference between, what is the responsibilities of Congress for checks and balances with the president and the president? Congress passes bills. So I said early on that we have two responsibilities, lawmaking and representation. So Congress is responsible for passing bills. The president signs or vetoes those prospective bills. President's State of the Union Address formulates policy. President executes laws and is in charge of administering the executive branch. We'll talk more about that when we get into presidency next week. Congress, on the other side of that, exercises oversight over executive branch activities. President appoints cabinets, ambassadors, judges to federal courts, but Senate has advice and counsel in those roles. President represents national constituency. Congress represents district or state constituency. So you should know the difference between, from a checks and balances standpoint, the roles and responsibilities of Congress and the president, which ones overlap if they do, which ones Congress has responsibility to related to the executive branch, which ones can the executive branch do without consent and counsel from the Congress. Congress makes the laws. The courts interpret them. Congress sets up the federal court systems and determines the compensation or salaries for individuals in that system. Congress decides jurisdiction, where these courts are going to be held, and then what cases they will hear. Congress passes legislation that limits courts' discretion to rule or impose sentences. So Congress has a big job. I mean, these guys and these ladies have a lot of work ahead of them that they are responsible for doing. No doubt. So there's bound to be conflict, there's bound to be disagreement, but then on the flip side of that, there's bound to be compromise, and compromise should be used when it's necessary. With regard to dividing up geography and determining who fits into a congressional district, here's some things that you should understand. Politics of defining congressional districts includes reapportionment. Reapportionment is the reallocation of congressional seats, all right, among the states that happens following the census every 10 years. So if we're in 2017, what's the next year that we're bound to have a census? When did we have the last census? Apportionment is aligned with the census. You should remember that. Redistricting, though, is the process of redrawing boundaries, district lines in states with more than one representative carried out by state legislators or commission. So, for example, in the state of California, we had some issues around redistricting where some people felt that it was to the advantage of the legislators, and this had been their role all along, that it was to their advantage to redraw district lines in their favor, that they would draw them in such a way that who they represented was a plus for them, and that some people got left out of appropriate representation. Some groups were left out. Some people were marginalized in the representation piece. And so voters went to the polls and voted on the ballot initiative that determined, and it was voted yes, that determined that there would be an independent commission of non-biased, unbiased individuals who would represent constituents in the state of California to determine redrawing district lines. So redistricting, drawing the boundaries, and we did that all over again a couple years ago, where some people who had been recently elected into assembly and state positions within the state of California, after the lines were drawn, they lost their districts. They lost their representation. They were out of a job. The way that the lines, the boundaries were redrawn or redesigned, there was overlap into some districts where there was a clear delineation between one district and another, And so some of that folded over into the new district, and the person that was representing the part that they lost their assemblyship or lost their Senate position. So redistricting is a process of redrawing of district lines in states with more than one representative, and it's carried out, in our case in California, it's carried out by an independent commission. So I see that we have a caller on the line. Let me go ahead and take the call. Who's calling? Dominic from Rosemead. Welcome to the program.
Yeah. Hi.
Hi.
I have a question based on the Electoral College and how it's run.
The Electoral College. Now, the Electoral College isn't part of today's conversation on the Congress, but what's your question?
Why is it that even though it's run by, I guess you could say, the amount of people in the state, why is it that smaller states like Ohio have gone completely, every time a president has run for election, ever since Ohio has been admitted, no president has ever won without Ohio. Why is that the case? Why is it not just every state gets one electoral vote?
It's based on population. Ohio is real. Well, how many do we have in the state of California? How many electoral votes do we have in the state of California? We have a lot. We have a large state, right? And Ohio is a pretty small state with a fairly low number of electors in that state. But that's a good question. Why is it that a presidency cannot be won without Ohio? Can you hold that, Dominique, since we're talking about Congress this week until we get to the presidency next week?
All right.
Thank you. If you have one on Congress, give it to me. You have one on Congress?
Yeah, for Congress, it actually kind of has to do a bit with the homework. Why aren't term limits imposed on Congress members? Because wouldn't it allow for people to, wouldn't it make things a lot more balanced and bring a lot newer people into our government, allowing for new ideas and all sorts of different things, I guess you could say?
Absolutely. And so that's been, thank you for that. Now that's related to Congress and goes back to the extra credit question that you guys had for the week. That's an excellent question in that it has been challenging to get those term limits. And so who needs to make that determination whether or not we should have term limits? Because it is good to have new blood, to have fresh blood come in, new intellect, new knowledge, new passion to come in and do the work of the people. And we haven't had that in some instances for a while. But whose responsibility is it to make sure that that happens or that there's a possibility that that can happen? It's us, the voters. And so we have to make a determination whether or not it's important enough for us to put it on a ballot initiative to say, this is something that we think should happen. And when we don't get, in some instances, this has been pursued by petition for people to sign up and say, okay, we need enough votes to be, we need enough signers to be able to put this on the, to be approved to put it on the ballot for an election to, you know, say whether or not we, to vote whether or not we want to actually have something like this happen. And not enough people care. Not enough people are concerned about it. You have people like Dianne Feinstein, who's been Senator Feinstein, with all the wonderful work that she's done as senator and representing the United States and representing California for something like 26, 28 years. You have Barbara Boxer, who just stepped down, did not run for re-election in 2016, who was in office for something, again, the same period of time as Dianne Feinstein, 26 years. When you have a situation like that, you have a lot of good knowledge that's entrenched in the work that they do, and it's not necessarily an easy task to transition that knowledge over, but as long as things are documented, as long as there's a trail of what work has been done and what work needs to be done, and there's a constituency base that's involved, we should have, I agree, that we should have term limits to bring in new people. But until we as voters go to the polls and say and demand that this is something that we believe is in the best interest of the greater whole, it's not going to happen. I hope that answers your question from my opinion.
All right. Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you for asking. Thank you for calling in. Okay. Gerrymandering is the opposite of redistricting. Gerrymandering is not good. Gerrymandering is bad. And gerrymandering happens It happens, and when it happens, it is a bad thing, okay? It kind of goes back to what I was saying when district lines are drawn or boundaries are drawn to the advantage of the legislator and leaving out constituents that are no longer represented or misrepresented. That's what gerrymandering is. It's redistricting to benefit a particular group. Not good. All right? So that is outlaw. That's against the law. But does it happen? Absolutely. In fact, we're going to take you to two video clips right quick. Both of them are about 2 minutes, a little bit more than 2 minutes. One is on census and appropriation and apportionment, and the other one is on gerrymandering. So let's take a look at the first one, come back at me with your thoughts, and then we'll flip to the second one on gerrymandering specific and move on.
We, the people of the United States.
The mandate for the census is right here, just a few sentences into the Constitution.
Representatives shall be apportioned among the several states according to their respective numbers.
Apportionment. The dividing of seats in the House of Representatives among the 50 states. But how does it actually work? Since the 1940 census, Congress has used the method of equal proportions, which follows this formula.
A sub n equals P over the square root.
Okay, don't worry about the math. Just think of the formula as an apportioning machine. First, the Constitution calls for each of the 50 states to have at least one seat. So subtract 50 from the current House total of 435, and you have 385 seats left. Next, the apportionment machine ranks the states by population according to the census. Then the machine starts giving out seats. After each seat is distributed, the machine re-ranks the remaining states based on the formula until all seats are distributed. This process ensures that each congressional district from Maryland to California has roughly the same number of people. In 1790, each House member represented only about 34,000 people. In 2000, each member represented on average 647,000 people. Since the first census, the decennial count has been the basis for our representative form of government. And as our country grows, the apportionment process ensures equal representation for all, just like the Founding Fathers planned. Apportionment, another gift from our nation's founders, who transformed the census from a tool of government into a tool of empowerment for the people.
Okay, so that was on apportionment, and then the next one that you're going to see is on gerrymandering. But I want you to understand there are some different types of gerrymandering that occur that are really, as I said earlier before, not good. There's pro-incumbent gerrymandering, and this again is districts redrawn to maximize the chances of an incumbent winning. There's partisan gerrymandering. This is the process of a particular state legislature whereby the majority party draws districts to maximize the number of House seats their party could possibly win. And the last one is racial gerrymandering. This is redistricting to enhance or reduce the chances that a racial or ethnic group will elect members to their legislature. All right, so majority minority districts after Voting Rights Act of 1982, and this is deemed unconstitutional by the U.S. Supreme Court. So moving on to who can run for Congress. Well, I gave you some indicators about age and residency, citizenship. Who can run? Age, citizenship, and residency qualifications. You can refer back to the text where you have the chart that shows you that information. Why would anyone want this job? Excellent question. Why would anyone want this job? Well, there's a sense of duty. There's a sense of doing the right thing. There's a sense of personal fulfillment. There's a sense of familial obligation. There's ideology that we have that we need to do something, and this is what we need to do and how we're going to do it, and we can best do it in this mode or this way. Okay? There are excellent pay, wonderful perks, and a lot of power comes with this position for anyone that runs for either one of those opportunities. But then are there downsides? There's absolutely some downsides, and I'll tell you those in just a minute after I take this call. So who do we have on the line?
Jordy.
Hey, Jordy, how are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm fine, thank you. What's your question or comment?
I just had a question like, could people born in Puerto Rico, can they, like, run to be a congressman? And, like, if not, like, how come? Because if you're born in Puerto Rico, I know that you're considered a U.S. citizen.
Puerto Rico is one of our U.S. territories, right?
Yes.
Okay, so do we have representation right now in Congress from a from anyone in Puerto Rico? Or from the U.S. Virgin Islands?
I'm guessing so.
I'm sorry?
I'm guessing, yeah, I guess. I think, maybe.
You think, maybe? Google it and tell me.
All right.
Are you in the class now?
Hold on a sec.
Jordy? Hello? Did I lose him? Okay, I think I did. Jordy, I want you to call back in when you get your when you get the answer. Do we have any congressional representation from the House of Representatives or from the Senate in Congress from Puerto Rico, U.S. Virgin Islands, or the Philippines? Let me know. Downside to wanting to do this job or anybody wanting to get into this kind of work, it is hard work. I said that a few minutes ago. Very low job security. Now, why would there be very low job security? You guys answer that one for me. And it's very expensive to run for Congress. It's something that you have to really be in it with your heart and your soul. It is a firm commitment that you have to want to do something like this. In many instances, there's an invasion of privacy. You give up your right to privacy. And that in itself is a reason why people may not be so willing to want to participate or run for this type of job. But you have to take all those things into consideration and ask yourself, is this the right thing for me as an individual? And if you're part of a family, is this the right thing for my family? So there's a lot of things that you have to weigh, but there are a lot of people who weigh those things and say, yes, this is what I want to do. This is something that I want to achieve. On behalf of the American people. So there is a clip that I wanted you to see on what sorts of things should you consider if you want to run. There's something we call the coattail effect. Let's go ahead and take a look at that. It's about a minute and a half long, and then I'll pick up some of your comments. Okay, so we're having a little bit of difficulty with that, so let me just move on until they tell me that we're ready for that particular clip. Who gets elected? We just talked about who would want to run for this position or run for office. Now, when they do, when they decide to do it, of course, now the video is ready, but when they decide to do it, who gets elected? Congress does not represent the public demographically, but vast majority of members of Congress are white males. So what does representation really look like? Who gets elected? How many women do we have in Congress? How many men? What's the minority makeup of Congress? Is it totally homogenous? Is it just one? Does everybody look the same, or is there some diversity? What does that diversity look like? Okay, representative from a minority standpoint, women, gender differences, racial differences, you tell me, what does it look like today? Is it representative, my point being, is it representative of our population in the United States for American citizens? All right, there's descriptive representation, which is the idea that an elected body should mirror demographically the population it represents. So that's what I'm asking you. For what we have in Congress today, for the individuals that represent us, does it reflect demographically the population that we have in the United States for representation? Okay. Go ahead and watch this next clip on the coattail effect and then come back at me with your thoughts.
Okay. Coattail effect, you got to have a popular presidential candidate. Okay, and if you have a popular presidential candidate running for office, a lesser known candidate from the same party can benefit from being on the same ticket. So people might vote for the Senate or the House candidate simply because they're the same party. So if Chris Christie won the nomination in 2016, people might vote for a Republican senator or Republican House member if Chris Christie is really popular in public opinion polls. Expanding the power of the people, or the electorate. When you're talking about the people in a voting capacity, you're going to call them the electorate, because they're the ones responsible for getting people elected. Oops. Let me fix it. That's fine. Okay. So when you're talking about expanding the power of the people, you're expanding the power of the voters to make decisions. The first time in all of this, to be honest with you, this is all phenomenon that was born out of the progressive era. If you remember, the progressive era was to try to stop corruption within the government, stop party machines like Boss Tweed, try to reform the government, making the government more fair and clear. So an easy way to make the government more fair and clear in a democracy is to give the people more power. One way we gave the people more power is through initiative. We allow voters to petition or propose policy, and that would look like if the voters of California wanted to see a piece of legislation that would build a fence across the border with California and Mexico, the voters of that state could propose that policy. And then it would have to go to vote. So it's kind of like the voters becoming legislators. Referendum allows citizens to vote directly on issues. Generally, these issues are called propositions, or you can vote to amend the state's constitution.
Jordy asked about, I think it was Jordy who asked about Puerto Rico, and Puerto Rico has a non-resident representative in the House of Representatives who represents the interests of Puerto Rico. So that's where we have the representation come from. That's how it's done. So Jordy, I was waiting for you to give me a call back to answer that one, but that's the answer to that question. Okay, so let me go to some of the questions or comments that you guys have made. I want to be fair and give you guys some conversation on that right quick. All right. Dominic's question is, why are parties so important? Because if there were not any, then people would be forced to be informed because they couldn't go with the flow of the party. Dominic, that question is very confusing. I think what you're asking is, why do we have political parties? And if we didn't have them, then people would have to be educated and informed on the issues. But then if we didn't have them, who would represent us? Because if we all tried to represent our own interests and concerns, it'd be kind of chaotic. We wouldn't have any order or process. So I'm a little bit confused on your thought process there. Mark says, the difference between the House and the Senate is that the House focuses on what the people of a state need and want and responds directly to the people's problems. The Senate focuses on what the state government needs and wants and works on the overall. Thank you, Mark. Emily comments that Congress as a whole is responsible for creating, editing, and presenting legislation and policies. However, she says, the House and Senate differ in some ways. The House has significantly more people than the Senate, and its term limits or term lengths are shorter. Senators are elected by state legislatures, but members of the House are elected directly by the people. Senators are elected by state legislatures. Are you sure on that one, Emily? We just elected in the state of California former Attorney General Kamala Harris to fill the position of Barbara Boxer. I believe that was a vote that we went to the polls for in November in our ballots and voted for that. So that would be the people voting for that senator position. I don't think anything's changed on that, but if you find something different, let me know. Alessandra says, what are some benefits of having limits for people who run for office or Senate or the Senate? What are some benefits of having age limits for people who run for office or the Senate? Well, I think from my perspective or my opinion, some of the benefits would be education. So having education, having some experience, having some life experience, having some education more than high school, so and being exposed to different situations in your community, in your state, having a broad understanding of what goes on in government, having a very good understanding of what goes on in government and the functions of government, the responsibilities and roles of government, what kinds of issues are prevalent to American society today, what could be on the forecast for us tomorrow or 5 years from now. And so having a very good knowledge, and you can't necessarily, you don't necessarily have that as a 16, 17, 18-year-old. You may not even have it as a 20-year-old. So the term limits, age limits, I think, in my opinion, are appropriate, Alessandra. Janae asked, before I do this caller who's called in, Janae asked, what are the positive effects on placing terms on congressmen and women? Congress, what are the positive effects on placing terms? We talked about that, Janae, while your comment was probably already on here a little bit ago when I gave my opinion about the thoughts on having term limits relative to new blood coming in, fresh ideas, people who are really interested in wanting to address situations that are current and relevant to today, a new order, something that is that people can look at and say, she or he speaks for me now, as opposed to perhaps the old guard that's been there for a little while, even though the old guard may be doing a fantastic job. We need to have some turnover of new ideas and thoughts, innovative and creative opportunities to come up with legislation and policy, lawmaking that is reflective of what's going on in society today. All right, I'll take the caller. And who's calling?
Hello?
Hey, Jordy. You got an answer?
Hey, how you doing?
Good, good.
I have another question. What's the point, like, nowadays of being, like, represented by people in Congress when there's, like, many, like, organized interest groups that, like, bring the attention or the concerns of other people to, like, the attention of, like, the government?
Okay, so we have interest groups, and yes, we have lobbyists and interest groups who do bring issues forward to government, but what government? What part of government? Who are they bringing these issues to? They can't go directly to the president, so who do they go through? They go through our representatives, right? So you,
yeah.
If you're in Washington, D.C., or if you get to even up to Sacramento, you will often see lobbyists and special interests walking the halls trying to meet with our representatives to share with them what their concerns are for the groups that they represent to affect and influence policy and legislation. So if we didn't have representatives and we had just the lobbyists and special interests going directly to someone, who would that someone be? Because they can't get in the door of the president. Who would they go to? Does that make sense?
Okay. Yeah, that makes sense.
Okay. Thanks, Jordy, for your call.
All right. Thank you.
You're welcome. Kenneth says, can congressional gerrymandering be related to when FDR wanted to add some younger justices to counter the older justices, but the new ones he was planning to add were in his party? People accused him of manipulating the system to be a dictator. Can this be related to gerrymandering? Unfortunately, no, Kenneth. It's kind of different. And gerrymandering has to do with geography and districts, whereas FDR situation was a politically, both of them are politically oriented, but his was a political manipulation of the system for putting people in place, for cronyism and loyalist, which may not necessarily have been the right thing to do, but it is different from gerrymandering. We had a caller, but we don't now. Okay. Shane says, related to Congress, why do we operate under a republic instead of a true democracy? Why? This question has come up so many times. Why is it better to place our trust in people who can be corrupt when we could vote on legislation ourselves? Okay, Shane, I'll take the last part of your question. Why is it better to place our trust in people who can be corrupt when we could vote on legislation ourselves? In reality, as large as the state of California is in this nation, we have the lowest voter turnout, sadly. The lowest voter turnout over the last, 20 years compared to other states where the constituency, the voters, the registered voters, people who are eligible to vote actually exercise the opportunity and the right to vote. And as the population in California gets bigger, our numbers for voting get lower are actually lower. So if we don't put our trust in people who represent us and represent our needs, yes, you're going to have some corrupt situations. Yes, you're going to have some illegal and integrity situations. But if it depended on voters to go to the polls to pass legislation or determine legislation that was in the benefit of the greater whole, we'd probably not get anything done that was fair and equitable to the majority. So I don't know. We need to do something to improve our voter turnout just here alone in our own state, given the numbers that we've seen, the percentages that we've seen over the last 10 to 15 years. Pretty sad. Pretty sad. Hoping that you guys as a new generation can come through, and when you are registered to vote, when you are eligible to vote, that you register to vote, and then not just register to vote, but you actually exercise the right and opportunity to be informed and go vote. We have an election coming up next week on March the 7th in some of our areas. So it'll be interesting to see what the voter turnout is for where elections are going to be held in the state. And I'll share that with you when we meet on Monday, March the 13th, because the election is on March the 7th. So again, that'll be interesting next Tuesday. Okay, how Congress works from an organizational standpoint, you have a central role of the party. Parties are frequently vote in unison in Congress. Majority party controls the leadership structure, and then increasing prevalence of hyperpartisanship does actually occur within the structure and the organization of Congress. We talked at the very beginning about the Speaker of the House and the role of the Speaker of the House. They are the majority party leader. In Speaker Ryan's case, he's going to be prepping members of the Republican Party in Congress to work with President Trump on whatever the president's agenda is that he's going to speak about tomorrow when he speaks to Congress. Okay, they serve as the presiding officer of the House, meaning the House of Representatives. They're third in line to the president in terms of if something happens to the president, they succeed the president, the vice president, and then comes the Speaker of the House to take over presidency. Speaker has more power in House than majority leader has in the Senate. Our first female speaker was replaced after the 2010 midterm election due to a change in the House majority. Anybody know who the speaker was? Nancy Pelosi. Leadership power depends on person and the amount of power given by the party members as it relates to the Speaker of the House. Then you have what we call committee. We have a committee system, and at the beginning I told you that there were different types of committees. There's a lot of committees. There's committees in the 20 committees in the House, and there's 16 committees in the Senate. So standing committees are permanent. They're standing. They're permanent committees responsible for legislation in particular policy areas. They can draft that legislation, and then they provide oversight once the legislation is passed. You have committee chairs who have a considerable amount of power. By example, on the clip that you saw with Chavez and the EPA, the drilling that was going on about the Flint, Michigan water situation. You also have the House Rules Committee, which determines how and when debate on a bill will take place. You have select committees, joint committees. I'll let you guys look up what each one of those are. But getting on the right committee is really essential for members of Congress. They want to make sure that they can be placed where their expertise, their knowledge, their education, can contribute to legislation that's going to be addressed. You have conference committees, you have congressional resources, which are staff and bureaucracy. So each one of these committees has, and each one of your congressional members have a staff that supports the work that they do. It could be research, it could be coming up with the actual policy, writing the policy that then the representative or Senate person will represent and bring to the floor. All right, so how does Congress work? They have separate houses, identical bills. There's the bicameral legislature. There's fragmentation of legislative power where committees break up legislation. And then there are what we call norms of conduct, certain ways that you behave. There are informal rules that govern the behavior in Congress. And so there's some norms, and then there's some things that are done a little bit different. Norms over time have changed, leading to increasing adversarial behavior, which leads to partisanship, which leads to hyperpartisanship. We had an example of that during one of the confirmation hearings a couple of weeks ago, where one of the senators got up and quoted from Coretta Scott King, a letter from Coretta Scott King about Jeff Sessions. And the hearing wasn't about Jeff Sessions, it was about someone else, but she brought this letter in and she was chastised by the committee and told to sit down basically for having had that, bringing in the letter, having had that conversation. And so there's a lot of power that's enforced. There's a lot of power that is given to these individuals on these committees. And you have to behave in a certain way, and that behavior is expected. So there's norms, and then when you fall out of those norms, there's consequential behavior that happens and consequences from that behavior that arise. Getting on the legislative agenda, you have the president with the State of the Union that happens every January. You have exercise, where exercise is the role as policy entrepreneur, and it's highly, comes along with a highly publicized agenda. And then you have what's the legislative process, which is what our congressional members are there to do, is to enact through the lawmaking a legislative process where a bill is introduced or legislation is introduced, it moves through committees, most often dies here, or it gets sent back and edited for markups. It could die again once the markups are done and it's presented to the floor again. How do you get to the floor? The House has very strict rules on debate from the Rules Committee. The Senate can offer amendments or filibuster, which is stopped at, by cloture. And then the final challenge is consideration by the full House and or Senate. You have a roll call vote. If the bill passes with different language where it's been marked up, edited, changed, and approved, it must go to conference committee. And then the president can either kill the bill through veto or agree on it. Congress can override the veto with how much? Two-thirds vote in each of the chambers. All right. So there is a video clip that I wanted you guys to see next. And we're going to skip down to how does a bill become law? This is Mr. Bill, and hopefully we have time for this. This is a three-minute video clip that we're going to see. If you watch Schoolhouse Rock, which I've introduced Schoolhouse Rock to you a couple of times in a couple of our sessions, you'll appreciate this one. You might remember it as you were younger. So let's go ahead and look at it, see the clip, come back at me with your thoughts, and we'll conclude our session in a couple of minutes.
Whew, you sure got to climb a lot of steps to get to this Capitol building here in Washington. Well, I wonder who that sad little scrap of paper is.
I'm just a bill, yes, I'm only a bill, and I'm sitting here on Capitol Hill. Well, it's a long, long journey to the Capitol City. It's a long, long wait while I'm sitting in committee, but I know I'll be a law someday, at least I hope and pray that I will, but today I am still just a bill.
Gee, Bill, you certainly have a lot of patience and courage.
Well, I got this far. When I started, I wasn't even a bill. I was just an idea. Some folks back home decided they wanted a law passed, so they called their local congressman, and he said, "You're right, there ought to be a law." Then he sat down and wrote me out and introduced me to Congress, and I became a bill. And I'll remain a bill until they decide to make me a law. I'm just a bill, yes, I'm only a bill, and I got as far as Capitol Hill. Well, now I'm stuck in committee, and I'll sit here and wait while a few key congressmen discuss and debate whether they should let me be a law. I hope and pray that they will, but today I am still just a bill.
Of those congressmen arguing. Is all that discussion and debate about you?
Yeah, I'm one of the lucky ones. Most bills never even get this far. I hope they decide to report on me favorably, otherwise I may die.
Die?
Yeah, die in committee. Oh, but it looks like I'm gonna live. Now I go to the House of Representatives and they vote on me.
If they vote yes, what happens?
Then I go to the Senate and the whole thing starts all over again.
Oh, no.
Oh, yes. I'm just a bill, yes, I'm only a bill, and if they vote for me on Capitol Hill, well, then I'm off to the White House where I'll wait in a line with a lot of other bills for the president to sign. And if he signs me, then I'll be a law. I hope and pray that he will. But today I am still just a bill.
You mean even if the whole Congress says you should be a law, the president can still say no?
Yes, that's called a veto. If the president vetoes me, I have to go back to Congress and they vote on me again, and by that time you're so old.
By that time, it's very unlikely that you become a law. It's not easy to become a law, is it?
No, but how I hope and pray that I will. But today, I am still just a bill.
He signed your bill, now you're a law.
Oh, yes!
All right, so you saw how a bill becomes law. All right, let me just tell you that our role as citizens in Congress, what are we supposed to do? We talked about voting. We talked about exercising that opportunity to have our voices heard. We talked about running for the office, whether you want to run for House of Representatives or you want to run for Senate, what the requirements are for each of those, what the criteria is for that to happen. We've covered a lot of different concepts. But we as citizens, what is our responsibility to Congress and with Congress as citizens? Less than a third of the public approves of the way Congress is handling its job. I gave you some Gallup poll trends for the last 3 years, including this year. The changing nature of campaigns, voter cronyism, voter cynicism, and candidates running against Congress, well, there's a lot of issues around all of that. Negative media coverage of Congress, the role of money in congressional elections, and dissatisfaction with politics, well, we have to get more involved. You know, democracy is messy. Hyperpartisanship and polarization have led us to be cynical about Congress. But we have a responsibility to act and to do what we need to do to make sure that our representatives are doing their job, to hold their feet to the fire. So when you're not pleased with something, get involved. Find out who your representative is. Ask the hard questions. Make them do the work that we elected them to do. Okay, I had one more video for you, but I'm going to actually put it up on Blackboard so you can see it on your own. And I'm going to close out our session today. Next week, we'll be talking about the presidency and bureaucracy, so get prepared for that. And that's it. All of your quick write number twos have been graded. And your extra credit questions, look for those. I appreciate the comments and questions that you guys had today. And I look forward to seeing you next week.